in this edition of Art Loft. See the world in 360 degrees.
A little planet is a way to view one location where everything is focused on that one location.
Look up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane, it's Florida Supercon.
I remember going into Woolworths in England with my granddad and buying my first Superman comic.
If this walls could talk, they speak loudly.
And murals were used as a tool, and because they're narrative, they spoke out.
And a serial killer on the loose.
53rd Street, please.
You got any luggage?
No.
Good. Trunk is full.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.
Hello, I'm Jessie Schuster, and from Tits Comics in Lauderhill, this is Art Loft. Welcome to tonight's show. Our first story comes to us from the Lone Star State. Everything may be bigger in Texas, but for Houston-based photographer Sid Moen, who specializes in wide-angle photography, it's all about making the world into little planets.
My name is Sid Moen, and I'm a Houston photographer. I saw a little planet about 4 years ago on the internet, and I thought, I can do that. And I found it very interesting. I've always been intrigued with the spatial aspect of spherical photography. VR photography is virtual reality photography. So if you've ever gone to Google Maps and looked at a street view and where you can pan around and see 360 degrees around that block, that's VR photography. A stereographic projection is a mapping term, and that's how a 3D sphere is mapped 2D. But you see a globe, you know, the Earth, that you can kind of turn. Okay, that's a 3D thing. But you can also see maps of the world that are 2D, and that would be a stereographic projection. I take 30 photographs. So I take a picture, picture, picture. So it's 360 degrees all the way around, and I get all the sky and all the ground. Then I take it into the computer and I stitch the image together. There are a lot of seams, so there's a bit of time in that. And then I use mapping software to help me get the little planet view. A 360 degree panorama is a spherical image, and you can see the 3D aspect on a computer, but a little planet is the same image, only it's mapped 2D. That's the way you see all the whole image around you. What I like about little planets, it's not like a traditional panorama where you're kind of looking like this. It's all in front of you, and I think that's what attracts me to it. And it's different. I like that it's different. It's a little surrealistic, and I like that. And I'm always surprised at people who can say, oh, I know that. I mean, it's like I said, well, you get an A+ because you've named all the locations, because sometimes I think some of them are a little obscure. What first attracts people is whether it's an iconic image, let's say like the River Oaks Theater, which everybody loves that one. And I want you to look at that, and you know, I just want to attract you to my art first. And usually that's what it is. It'll be some iconic image that people know or, you know, resonates with them. But once they get into it, then they start kind of looking around. You'll see people kind of turning their head, you know, because they're kind of looking around and they're going, oh, there's that shop there, or, you know, there's that. So you do kind of connect to a place, even though it may not be the big fancy place. It's the little place that you see. Well, my favorite one is the shrimp boats. It was taken down in Galveston, where the shrimp boats come in. I can't get the view now because there's a building, but it was a spectacular sky, and I love being down by the water, and I think, you know, working people are interesting too. Little planets, it's kind of the idea that the world revolves around me, and a little planet is a way to view one location where everything is focused on that one location. And you can see all around it, but maybe you're focusing a little bit more on one part. And it's just kind of a celebration of the place.
Moen got the idea to create this type of art when she and her colleagues landed a contract to integrate VR photography and special effects for the petrochemical industry. Learn more at sidmoen.com.
As you get into the 70s and 80s and the 90s, you'll see a change in color. The temperature is much warmer, hotter. You'll still see some of the earlier concepts of survival.
From the art of photography, we turn to the art of myth-making, comic book style. During last year Florida Supercon, Art Loft met with creative artists behind our favorite superheroes. And now, we can even reveal the secret identity. Take a look.
I started when I was a kid. I was 16 years old in the country I was born in, Argentina. My dream was always to do the comics here. For me, it was my fulfillment of my dream. Mis primeros trabajos aquí en los Estados Unidos fue hacer un cowboy, Billy the Kid. Y después de Billy the Kid, they gave me to do most of the TV series of those times. From there, I moved to Gold Key to do the Yellow Submarine. And from the Yellow Submarine to DC Comics. From DC Comics to Marvel Comics. The character that I enjoy doing is Batman. Batman is not just a superhero. Doesn't have those incredible superpowers. It's more a detective than a superhero. And as a regular human being can be hurt. Bullets can kill him. And he uses a lot of gadgets to do his work. I'm semi-retired, you know, and I'm still doing things, you know, because doing little pictures is my life.
I was a kid who loved to read comic books. Comic books were always interesting to me. I discovered very early on that I was very good at drawing, and I just continued on, and you know, to work my way toward where I always knew I would be by the time I was five. What we've done with this particular Superman is that we kind of strip down his ability and make him less super omnipotent and more of a Superman. Heroism should be hard. You know, it should be something that's a difficult concept, even for someone who's superpowered. They should be challenged to the point where we can really appreciate them and what they're doing. Much like medicine or law, art is a practice. It's a skill that needs to be honed. And it's something that you will be doing for the rest of your life, one, because you love us so much, but two, because you never feel you really quite have it all. There are gonna be days you're not gonna like what you do, and loving it is what keeps you there.
Well, I have very vivid memories of superheroes when I was very, very young. In fact, I remember going into Woolworths in England with my granddad and buying my first Superman comic. ever since then, when I was like 7 years old, I just loved superheroes and Superman. And I think it was also a bit of falling in love with American culture, because, you know, American culture is intertwined with superheroes for me. Jack Kirby drew many of my favorite comics when I was a kid. It's been a huge influence to me. I think the favorite part of the creative experience for me is the bit where it's all still possible. It's when you've had the idea and you're just exploring it and you're doing really rough drawings or really roughly drafting a story out, and everything is very possible at that point. And that's still where the magic is. The other end of it is a bit more craftsmanlike, but it's really that the little moment where the light bulb goes off. That's, to me, is a really, really exciting part.
When it came to Marvel, they had a policy of giving books they had canceled to newcomers and let them kind of try out on it because they figured they couldn't hurt it. One of them was Iron Man, and I told David to take Iron Man. And I had always hated what they had done with the Iron Man character. So I asked them, could we do whatever we want? And they said, yeah, we're going to cancel it. So we changed everything. That's where the rock star Tony Stark came in. That's where it came in looking like armor, and I did the variant armors, and we created Rhodey, the whole new cast of characters. And after 3 issues, it was selling like 300,000 copies a month, and the rest is history. I wanted to go to Hollywood and work because I had done everything in comics. I had owned 2 comic book companies. I've done everything but put staples in the books. And I wanted to see my characters talk and move. Something like that. And so it was the next challenge for me.
I started off at 3 years old. I loved to draw, and in high school, I won a couple of awards for Youth Today magazine. I started drawing at 17 with commercial art, you know. And from there, the war broke out. I designed a plane, and I was drawing the field manual for the Army. And from there, I went to New York, and I worked for Steinberg Studio. And they says, would you like to draw Superman? And I said, I made a sample, they liked it. And I worked with Superman for 30 years. And from there, I went to Batman and the dailies. And every time some cartoonist got sick, I stepped in for them. If you could stay in a room and draw and not be lonely, stay with drawing.
This year, Florida Supercon takes place July 3rd through the 6th at the Miami Beach Convention Center. So log on to floridasupercon.com for details. Up next, join us as we walk the halls of Texas Southern University in Houston. For more than 60 years, its walls have served as the canvas of expressive students. Lined with over 100 murals, these corridors are dripping with American history. Take a look.
Painting has been a required course on the Texas Southern University's campus since the inception of the art program. There are approximately 128 murals on the campus. Texas Southern University was founded in 1947. It was already an existing institution that became Texas State College for Negroes. Now we know it as Texas Southern University. Dr. Biggers was brought to Texas Southern University in the spring of 1948. He was already established as a muralist working at Penn State, and he had heard so much about Texas. So he pretty much enjoyed the South here and saw it as an opportunity to begin to tell the story of art and the community, because he saw it as a rich, vast territory. This building was the second building on the campus, and the art program was housed on the third floor. One of the first things they did was to begin painting murals. All these murals are by students. Many of the early students were former military recruits who had come here. So some of the first murals done in the early 50s show some of that experience. You'll see the importance of becoming successful and that success pretty much tied to education. You'll see reflections of the rural South, so you'll see cotton and other parts of the trade. As you move into the 60s and the civil rights movement begins to heat up, you begin to see some of the important figures of that civil rights struggle, including the presidents and Martin Luther King. As you get into the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, you'll see a change in color. The temperature is much warmer, hotter. You'll still see some of the earlier concepts of survival, of moving forward, of the importance of education. Religion is also very strong in these works. Kermit Oliver has two full murals as well as a few little vignettes, so he was quite prolific. You'll also see the murals of Jesse Cifuentes.
I came to Texas Southern in 1973. And the 70s was a different era. Well, the instruction was you have to paint a narrative. It has to tell a story. My mural is in a geometric form instead of the naturalistic representation. So it shows a family together. It shows a young family, and it shows also some grandparents. They're seniors. They have white hair, and they got grandchildren. When I see the murals now, I think about a history. It shows a legacy. It shows, it tells a story also. Each mural will give a different narrative of the time they were being painted.
My name is John Bullock, and I graduated in 2008. It's titled They Shall Be Filled. So I just really wanted to figure out a way visually to tie in the Old and the New Testament, as well as having Jesus as this centerpiece in the communion. It definitely is a rigorous process that you gotta really figure out how to tie all the pieces together. So the biggest part for me was to spatially represent, you know, this storyline and have something that people can kind of walk through and see, you know, a narrative. And I actually intentionally used some of the same color palette from that mural and my mural so they wouldn't compete too much and really work in harmony. I used to take breaks when I first started with just a bare white wall and a grid and kind of look at that mural just to kind of figure out kind of how they got to their end point and visualize how we get to mine. So it, you know, was a huge inspiration just to be right next to it.
Over the years that Dr. Biggers spent at Texas Southern, he developed quite a career for himself, as well as having motivated a number of students. Before his retirement, he did the large mural, which we think is his crowning jewel, in the Sterling Student Center. That's a wonderful large mural called Family Unity that reflects his change in style as well as his interest in the African diaspora. I would say that we have quite a unique experience on this campus where you're surrounded by works that tell stories and give you the history, but do so in a beautiful, quiet way. People can learn so much from the murals, and they have appreciated them over the decades.
The murals here at Texas Southern, I think, are treasures, as a pen is to a writer, the brush is to a muralist. And murals were used as a tool, and because they're narrative, they spoke out. So I think that it gave the artist a voice.
I think there's only a few people that can really say they're a part of a legacy of over 50 years. To be a part of this, it's a huge honor. This is a gem in the city of Houston and actually in the country. There's not too many places like this.
The University Museum at Texas Southern University is the permanent home of Web of Life, the masterpiece mural by John Biggers. For more information on this and other artwork on display, visit umus.edu. etsu.org.
We try to have the art move. We have people performing and showing you how they do their art. We have a young fellow named Joaquin who's a street artist who does spray can art.
Finally tonight, this animated short by Paolo Cogliati won the Best Student category at the 2013's MIA Animation Festival. In this flick, a woman takes a chilling ride when she realizes a cab driver could be a notorious killer. From MIA Animation, here's Serial Taxi.
Street, please.
You got any luggage?
No.
Good. Trunk is full. Nice weather today, huh? The cold. It is colder than the steel of a knife.
What do you do for fun?
Oh, you know, the usual. Just, killing time.
To bring you breaking news. The taxi killer has struck again, killing yet another poor taxi driver. The victims have all been foreign drivers with thick accents and large amounts of facial hair. The murder weapon has been revealed to be an umbrella in each case. The police chief tells us they have no...
How strange. Taxi!
Cogliati attended the Ringling College of Art and Design in Florida and is currently working on the feature film called Box Trolls. Learn more about him at paoloanimates.com. And remember, this year's MIA Animation Conference takes place October 10th and 11th. Registration to compete is still open, so don't wait. Log on to miaanimation.com. That's our show for tonight. Visit wpbt2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. Don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and now Instagram at artloftsfl. Thanks for watching, and remember, stay creative. Bye-bye. These corridors are dripping with American history. Take a look.
Wait, you have to keep going.
Oh, okay. Yohandi, please check complete. We should know, it's superhero style. So you're supposed to
fly.
Where's the Thor hammer?
Oh, don't hammer me.
The Thor hammer?
Yeah, she has it. She gave it to us earlier. Okay. Lynn, with over 100 murals, this corridor are dripping with American history.
Les sept boules de cristal venues des étoiles. Dragon Ball Z.
As we heard. Do you have the Zodiac Fighter or something like this? That's called. The University Museum at Texas Southern University is the permanent home. And remember, stay creative. Bye.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.